Brothers, sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. I recently received an email with an invitation that caught me a bit by surprise. Your 63-year-old interim pastor was invited to apply today to become a Minnesota State Highway Patrol officer. A whole lot of people would wonder what I was thinking were I entered that vocation, at least at this point in my life. But all this got me to thinking, what if it was my 20-year-old son or my 24-year-old daughter who were applying for that kind of a position? Or maybe more anxiety-producing for a parent, what if their callings called them to serve as immigration officials serving folk on the U.S.-Mexican border, or as infectious disease medical personnel serving in coronavirus quarantine settings? How would I feel about that? Now back to the lesson about John the Baptist. If I'd been a teenage friend of John's, before he ever accepted his calling to be prophet, I would have had a few questions for him. Have you lost your head? You want to be a prophet? What are you thinking? I think that's telling, actually, how some people use questions to make statements. The same person who asks, have you lost your head, is really suggesting that the person is thinking crazy. The same person who asks, you want to be a prophet, is really pleading that the person should weigh the cost of the consequences that will most certainly need to be faced. They're really suggesting that no one should want to be a prophet. They're voicing a warning that the costs to one's family, reputation, and future are simply more costly than one person or family should have to bear. So let's start over. Let's make a statement. John, you're saying yes to the role of prophet is going to get you killed. Brian Stoffergen used the following story in his sermon. As the story goes, there were two brothers who lived in Georgia during the 1950s. One decided that in opposition to the dominant culture of that day, he was going to support and participate in the formation of a multi-ethnic community. The other brother worked as an attorney for a prominent law firm. Both brothers were Christians. Both attended church regularly. And as that multi-ethnic community formed, social pressures began to push back. Court proceedings soon followed. And the one brother asked his attorney brother to help him with the legal work. The brother refused, saying that it would cost him his job. So the pressure increased from the first brother asking his brother to help with the legal proceedings yet again, along with a not-so-subtle reminder, you are a Christian. And the lawyer responded, I will follow Jesus to his cross, but it is his cross. I have no need to be crucified. Job security in a law firm was paramount in the values of the attorney brother. He also likely had a family to provide for. It's hard to blame him for not wanting to put his reputation at risk. A solid reputation is a gift indeed. Well, that said, the second brother was willing to place his reputation at risk for the sake of the future of a multi-ethnic community. One brother envisioned the future just as it was. The other brother envisioned the future transformed. Well, for me, today's gospel reading would be rated R, were it a movie. And that said, I want to create the first scenes for a made-for-television movie. And the first thing to observe is that this movie would begin at the end. The first scene would show a scantily clothed teenage girl dancing her way out through a doorway. Her mother, Herodias, would be left in the room holding a silver platter dripping with blood. And that's the end of the first scene. Scene two quickly moves to a dreary prison cell where the disciples of John the Baptist have come to ask for the body of their leader. They wrap up John's body in a large blanket and take it out into the community and eventually lay John's body into a cold, dark tomb. The rest of the movie, well, it's all a flashback. It serves as an explanatory unfolding of the tale of the events that led up to John's demise. And what an R-rated tale that is. Where do we enter the tale? I'm not going to talk about Herod and his brother Philip. I'm not going to talk about that woman that they both once called their wife. I'm not going to talk about the teenage daughter who could have made a name for herself during the Super Bowl halftime extravaganza last Sunday. I mean, why she could have been the one of the dance troupe surrounding Shakira and Jennifer Lopez. I mean, talk about scantily clad artists. But what I do want to talk about is, well, the group of people who were in that room, people who were listening and watching on the day of Herod's birthday celebration. And in the middle of that community celebration, puffed up Herod proclaimed for all to hear, "Ask me for whatever you wish. I'll give it even half of my kingdom." Well, you know what the request was. But now remember the king's response. The king was deeply grieved. Yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not refuse the request. Wow, watch out what you speak aloud in front of witnesses. More so, be alert for what is stirring in your subconscious when you realize that what you're choosing to say is contrary to what you believe in your heart. You're saying it for the sake of what others will think, when what would be more life-giving would ring as truth and honesty and maybe a whole lot of compassion. I guess what I'm trying to say is, when the spoken word becomes public, it takes on a life of its own. It can form blessing in the lives of people. It can become curse in the lives of the people. Have you ever been in a group of people listening and watching, and someone that you know, respect, and like says something that just catches you totally off guard? What is said grieves you and your greater community of friends and family. It amplifies with embarrassment and shame if that encounter includes alcohol or drugs. They're evident in the speaker's bloodstream. And when choices are made, well, they're not life-giving. They don't encourage much of a future with hope. No, Herod was grieved. And what motivated him in that moment was regret and maybe a bit of anger. It pushed him to do what he didn't want to do. But in the expediency of that moment, he said it anyway. The New Interpreter's Bible Commentary makes this suggestion regarding Herod's actions. Willingness to sacrifice others in order to maintain honor, prestige, and power remains one of the greatest temptations of persons in positions of authority. Barbara Brown Taylor once wrote in the Christian Century, "I remember being at a retreat once where the leader asked us to think of someone who represented Christ in our lives. When it came time to share our answers, one woman stood up and said, 'I had to think hard about that one. I kept thinking, who is it who told me the truth about myself so clearly that I wanted to kill him for it?' Yes, according to Scripture, Jesus died because he told the truth to everyone he met. He was the truth, a perfect mirror in which people saw themselves in God's own light." Thank you, Barbara Brown Taylor. Today we're learning that Jesus was a prophet. John was a prophet. I think it's fair to say that Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., Archbishop Romero, bravely lived in the prophetic tradition. I say that because when they spoke, crowds of people listened, and when they were gone, crowds of people grieved. Another has written regarding the witness of Gandhi and King and Romero, "Murder could not silence the messages of such leaders who taught and lived the principles of nonviolence and challenged oppression in many forms. The violent deaths of these leaders were tragic, needless loss to the world. However, the lives of such persons provide inspiration to generations of others who follow in their footsteps, a legacy that death cannot undermine." And when we cherish the teachings, ideas, and courageous actions of their lives, well, then their deaths will not have been in vain. You know, if we read today's gospel reading closely, Jesus doesn't speak. This is the only scene in all of the Gospel of Mark in which Jesus makes no appearance. For Mark, this gospel movie requires followers of Jesus willing to complete the movie in their generation. We disciples are called upon to speak the truth as Jesus lived the truth. You know, I, for one, I kind of like movies that keep me thinking. A scene may come out of nowhere that takes the viewer back in time without really giving you a clue that you're going back in time. So you have to keep watching to figure out the sequence for the whole story. Well, we heard Herod speak a single line today that was a clue for the understanding the plot of the whole movie. Herod proclaims, "John, who I beheaded, has been raised." You almost got it right. Jesus, who Pilate would sentence to death, it is Jesus, not John, who has been raised. And those of us disciples who follow in Jesus' footsteps continue to repeat the refrain, "Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again." And the one truly good guy in all of Scripture is Jesus. And look what happened to him. In the end, the powers that be think that they've acted to eliminate his voice and silence his message. Just as Herodias thought that she had silenced John the Baptist via his beheading. But that just isn't so. Watch the entire movie. Beyond the dark, cold tomb, Jesus is alive and well, risen indeed. Christ, the living Word, continues to have voice wherever bruised egos and tattered reputations are in need of healing and transformation. You know, there's not one of us who've not opened our mouth and regretted the toxic phrase that came out. This we confess at the foot of the cross. But today we come again to receive Christ's body and blood. We come confessing our imperfections, but we also come anticipating forgiveness and the amendment of life. Yes, Christ forgives and forgets, and Christ's disciples can too. Are we not children of the living God? There I go again, a question. Hey, this is who we are. We are the children of God. We are God's children, embodying Christ's vision for the amendment of life with all Christ's freedom and newness. Thanks be to God. Amen. As you're able, please stand as we sing.
We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need, saying, "Hear us, O God, your mercy is great." Let's pray. Gracious Lord God, as we hear the story of John the Baptist and his unfortunate end in that situation. We wonder, are we mere admirers of Jesus or are we followers? What risk might be involved in being a disciple of Jesus? John risked. He spoke out. He challenged people. Will we speak out, or will we see our faith as a mirror?